call it New York. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Ms. Evans, safety instructions.
Yes, sir. I'd like to call on Mr. Johnson to give us some safety instructions.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
To provide for the safety of those attending this meeting, I want to give the following instructions in case of an emergency. First, please take a moment to note where your exits are. If an emergency arises that prompts us to evacuate, I ask that everyone exit this room in a quick and orderly manner through one of the two doors to your right. Then proceed to the nearest stairwell, directions to which are indicated by exit signs. Once you exit the building, we ask that you safely cross the street to either of our parking lots to be safely away from the building. Our staff will provide help and directions and assistance. In the case of a tornado warning, we ask that you exit this room into the hallway where we will remain until it is safe to exit. In the event of an active shooter in the building, we will run if there is an accessible escape path, try to evacuate the premises, hide if you cannot evacuate, find a place to hide where you are less likely to be found, lock any doors that you can, fight as a last resort and only if your life is in intimate danger. Our staff will provide assistance on what to do. Thank you for your attention.
God, we thank you for another day. Thank you for the blessings of seeing and giving us another month. But thank you for life. Thank you for life, health, and strength. Bless now that our minds be centered around those we serve. And may our county a better place than we can live for Christ our Lord. Amen.
You receive the minutes of the previous meeting and agenda package. In addition to correction and not, is there a motion?
So moved.
Second. Questions? All in favor, let it be known by voting by aye.
Aye.
All opposed? And none of the minutes are approved. At this time, the public hearing is called to order. Receive citizen comments and questions relative to an adjustment agreement with Sarah Lee. The public hearing is called to order. Mr. Peters, would you please read the public notice?
Yes, sir. The Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners is considering entering into an agreement that will induce offering incentives to Sarah Lee Frozen Bakery for economic development purposes. Sarah Lee Bakery proposes to expand its parlor operations to include a capital investment of $19,800,000 and the creation of 108 new jobs over 2 years with an average annual wage of $40,681. The incentive being offered by the county is a cash grant paid to Sarah Lee Bakery in amount of 50% of an annual property taxes paid on any capital investment over a 5-year period. The Edgecombe County Board of Commissioners will conduct a public hearing during the regular meeting scheduled for March 2nd, 2020 at 7 p.m. The meeting will be in the Commissioners' Meeting Room, second floor of the County Administration Building in Farborough. The purpose of the hearing is to obtain citizens' input regarding this proposed agreement. Written comments should be addressed to Eric Evans, County Manager, P.O. Box 10, Farborough, North Carolina, 27886. Comments received by 10 a.m. on the day of the hearing will be considered.
Mr. Chairman. As you know, Carolina's getting a partnership acting on behalf of both Edgecombe County and the town of Farborough. Negotiated an agreement with Sarah Lee Bakery to encourage the expansion of their business here in the county. The result of those negotiations is that Sarah Lee agrees to create 108 new jobs at an average salary of $40,681. In addition, the company will invest at least $19,800,000 in improvements, upfit, and equipment. Upon certification that the company has met the obligations of the agreement, they will receive annually an amount equal to 50% of the property taxes paid over a 5-year period, provided you approve this inducement agreement. Following public comment, I recommend that you approve the attached inducement agreement with Sarah Lee Bakery.
At this time, if anybody from the public would like to speak, would you please come forward and state your name and address for the record?
Just stand up.
Anybody would like to speak on this time?
That's correct.
Seeing that no one wants to speak, the public hearing is adjourned. Consideration for approval. Is there a motion to approve this agreement?
So moved.
Questions? All in favor, let it be known by the voting sign aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, agreement is approved. At this time, we have scheduled appointments.
Mr. Chair, I know that for all of us, concern has been for a long time about broadband or the lack of broadband in many parts of our county. It's become so important as a part of our everyday life, education, health care, and a number of other things that our citizens have access to high-speed internet service that's affordable. So We've been in conversation with two different companies that are working to try to expand broadband here in the county. And I know here tonight we have representatives from CloudWise who would like to come and present to you about their company and what they're doing.
Thank you, Commissioners, for the opportunity to chat with you this evening. My name is Abraham Wilson. I'm the Executive Vice President of CloudWise. My colleague behind me is Chris Utesh, and he's our Business Development Manager. The presentation will be brief. We've broken it down sort of into three sets. The first will be a little bit about CloudWise, three or four slides on that, three or four slides on our current projects, and then three or four slides on what we are envisioning for Edgecombe County. And before I get started, I would like to thank Eric and Tabitha, as well as Winston Howell from the DNC. I think without their support and encouragement, we wouldn't be here tonight. So I really do express my appreciation to them. Also to Will Berg from Locality Networks, who I'm not sure is here. We have met with Will at this point and had a very productive talk about working together for the betterment of the county. And so with that, let me get started. So a little bit of a history on CloudWise. As you can see in the upper left, I mean, our vision is a world with high-speed broadband internet for all. Our history, we started in 2012 providing internet service to Wilmington residents, and believe it or not, at that time, you know, only almost 8 years ago, it was incredibly difficult to get quality internet within the city limits of Wilmington. And so we saw that as a need, we addressed it, and that really sort of got us going. And by 2015, we were the leading ISP in southeastern North Carolina. We started working at the state government's request with them. And by 2018, started looking very hard at what we call, it's a made-up word, by the way, internetification of rural North Carolina. And since that time, we've been awarded two major contracts, which we'll talk about in a few minutes, and are seeking additional support for projects in the upcoming grant cycle at the state level. And that's what we've been working with your folks on. I don't need to tell you much of this because I think you know it, you experience, you live it. But you know, having broadband, or even not having broadband, depending on which side of the coin you want to look, you know, it impacts education and educational opportunities, telemedicine, small business, e-commerce, telecommuting, and even ag tech. In parts of North Carolina that we've been working in, it's amazing to me. I was just terribly surprised at the lack of high-quality broadband. And without it, it's tough to be competitive. I think they call it the digital divide. And it exists, and it's quite large. And I'm sure, you know, as we talked about, it is real in Edgecombe County, and it's something that we take very seriously in terms of addressing and making a positive difference. You know, so I just wanted to focus for a brief minute on this slide, and it's talking about businesses as opposed to residents. But for businesses, we can deliver more than broadband. We can hosted phone services, cloud computing, all those things that can help from an economic development standpoint. We've been referred in other counties to help attract businesses because they insist upon having broadband. And we work with them on it. You can see some of the companies in the Wilmington area that we've worked with. But we also, because it's part of our culture, we give back to our community. You see the United Way, the Wilmington Chamber, but the Crandon Institute as well. If you're familiar with the Crandon Institute, they provide technology training to the youth and to senior citizens. And we're implementing programs with them to teach them how to use the internet and how to take advantage of that. So in terms of the local projects, now sort of shifting into phase two of the presentation, we have two. one with Nash County and one with Halifax County. The Nash County is a public-private partnership. They actually approached us in 2015. We knew there was a grant program under consideration at that time, but Nash County said, we don't want to wait for that. We want to go forward now. And so they provided a grant to us, which we then have a match involved. So we pay for some of it. They pay for the rest of it. Initial deployment, 30 homes, 30 businesses. But over time, 80% of the entire county will be covered through that program. And so we're empowering economic development. We've met with companies that Nash County has been trying to attract to propose internet service and high-speed service to those corporations. Halifax County, a different kind of grant. It's one under the North Carolina Great Grant Program, which Chris will talk about in just a second. But under that grant that was approved last year, we'll be serving almost 1,500 homes, 10 what's called anchor points, 24 businesses, 9 farming operations. And part of that, too, is we've entered into an agreement with Crandon, who I just mentioned, and are going to be offering literacy training, digital literacy training, to senior citizens and to the young people in Halifax County. So let's, before I turn it over to Chris, I mean, this is sort of what it looks like, and again, it's Nash County, because that's one that's already approved and well down the path and we're actually serving customers. But the circles represent towers and coverage areas in Nash County that the grant is intended to cover. And so you can see that, it starts, in Nashville, Castalia, comes down through Beaumire, and then to Bailey before swinging back up towards Rocky Mount. And we will have a good portion of the county that's able to be covered by those six towers. Some of those six exist right now, some we will actually construct ourselves. Halifax County, that's a little bit different map and really can't see the circles too well on it. But the thing I will point out about Halifax County, as opposed to Nash County, Halifax isn't paying a dime. They're getting broadband through the grant from the state government and through our company match. But there's no money that's coming out of the pockets of Nash County or its residents. And I think that's a really important thing. So Chris, I'm going to turn it over to you, and I guess this will be sort of taken up to the third part of the program.
Thank you. So just a quick overview. You guys are familiar with the Great Grant Program? Okay. So the two I want to stress is, I guess the top one there is providing service to the unserved and census blocks. And then at the bottom, the application was due on the 16th. So what we're looking for also is any sort of assistance or help you can provide to help us get surveys out there. Because true surveys from the citizens, and I'll show you the data in a second, but true surveys from the citizens are much, much more important than anything the SEC has or anything else we can pull together with some of our mapping tools to really show where the need is. If we get stewards of state's money, they want to make sure that it's going to areas that do truly need the service, and we need to help show that based on the current information. The other thing, I guess, to add on to that, so in 2019, it was for Tier 1 counties only. 2020, it's Tier 1 counties only. Next year, Tier 2 counties get into the mix. So that's going to add a whole new 40 counties that are up to 30% of the total grant funding, which will make it much more competitive for retention funds going forward in the years to come. This is the map of Edgecombe County that's showing the served and unserved areas. This is using the FCC Form 77 data. And of course, as you can see, the orange is considered the unserved areas based on the county. Now, again, the kicker with the data is if there's one entity or one residence or business being served in that census block, no matter what the size is, that's considered served. So if a gas station on the corner has service, and then a neighborhood of 1,000 homes behind has nothing, it's considered served. We can then refute that with survey data. This is another map. This is showing, this is American Community Surveys, which is part of the census. That's showing that we have 7,500 homes or households in Edgecombe County that have service, which is putting you right at a 31-32% of basically no internet access at the house. It's a little harder to read this, but the white or the lighter shaded areas are considered more served, and the darker the areas are, the less served they are. one of, we had initially proposed a project here trying to hit those current census block areas. So this is kind of just without having any conversations with you guys, trying to say, hey, this is what we're thinking. We want to get deeper more to, for the grant application to say, what is this actually going to be the best thing for you guys in Edgecombe County? So the review there, you know, hey, these are the areas that are showing service. So this is how we design our towers. The larger circles would be a full tower, and the smaller ones we double back on and kind of repeat. We use water towers, we use existing cell phone towers, so we can go in and replace existing phone poles with a pole three times the size, and then be able to use that to send a signal off. We can get really creative, and the best, one of the nice things about using fixed wireless is we can provide fiber quality and speed and connection with the latency, ping, and jitter with a fraction of the cost, because wirelessly they don't have to run the lines down the country roads or long driveways or anything like that. We're able to kind of cover a much larger area at a fraction of the cost. Which of course helps then keep the calls down for everybody else. So this is the proposed service area. We definitely understand that there's going to be some probably more need, but we want to also work with you guys to say, hey, we're trying to, you know, there's some work going on in principal, and to be important, Sarah Lee and other people y'all are trying to attract as well. Is there something that would be helpful and say, hey, I designed a perfect project, I want to have X coverage here or X speed there. Working with other counties, what is your biggest issue? Is it emergency fire? Is it schools? Is it public access? You know, every community has some of the same problems, but you also have specific ones that are related just with you guys. We want to make sure that we're coming along as a good partner to help put together a solution that makes the most sense for both of you guys. Any questions about any of this?
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
So the end user cost, how does it compare to broadband that's available through telephone or through Usenet, DirecTV? How do you guys compare against what's already offered?
Yeah, no, that's a good question. So the pricing hasn't been finalized. It's a little bit dependent on, you know, kind of how it all break down. But in Nash County, we're doing a 10 by 2 for $29.99, a 25 by 3 for $49.99, and then a 50 by 5 for $120.99. And those are all posted prices. You don't do any data capture restrictions. Basically, we treat it like a utility. So if I have X amount of water coming to my house, I want to run my systems, I want to have that number set. We do the same thing. So ours is wireless. So we actually send more than that signal a lot. So if it's 25 by 3, we're sending 27 by 5. You can always get it to run your devices, if you're streaming your homework, whatever, without having to get that slowdown. The nice thing is also, as we're building this network out, we're actually bringing in internet from other tier 2 providers. So we're going with MCNC and the bigger dogs like that, where we can get unlimited access to as much speed as we need. Current networks of DSL can be overloaded, and you can't add anybody new onto those. So we don't want to make anything worse for somebody who's currently on a service. We're bringing ours in completely independently. So that way also we can scale as much as we need over time.
Because, correct me if I'm wrong, the citizens have an option now of through telephone companies and satellite options. I mean, you guys are going to be another option.
Correct. So, and then I think we can go with the survey data I can show you from other communities. You know, typically that's either extremely expensive. Satellite has got poor latency, and so it takes a long time to upload things. And so you're constantly pulling down and trying to upload that video. And then they've got a cap. So after X gigabytes, you've got to pay $20 for a new token, and a new token, a new token. Our service doesn't work that way. And then separately also the upload. So a lot of times if you're trying to connect back, the satellite's got 25 miles, it's got to go up. The latency thing just takes forever. Sometimes what they're doing is they're using DSL to send your upload. So they'll connect to that, which helps a little bit. But yeah, and then with the cell phone, same kind of thing. And that's the other thought. We want to understand with the survey data, where is the most need? And is it this corner of the county or that corner? Or, hey, this area is pretty good. As a business, we do want to make a business case so we can stay here for a long time and you know, be making revenue. But we also understand that getting a service at a low affordable cost is imperative to making sure folks can get access. Is it? Yes,
now, there are some areas where those three companies you talked about, neither one of them will go to. So we do have pockets out in the northern area that none of those.
I thought if you had a hard landline telephone line, you could get a DSL and get wide and get broadband.
You do, depending on your circuit, and you're looking at 1 or 2 meg.
So you can't get it, it's just a matter of how fast.
The state designates SERP as 10.1, really 10.2. Because again, if you have a one, basically your phone, your app will use about 1 meg every device you have. If you're doing a TV, imagine 3 to 4, depending on what you're streaming. 4K might be 4 or 5. Well, that goes pretty fast. You've got somebody who's got this DSL subscriber line on their phone, they may not be able to get to the internet enough on that device to then get into whatever portal it is to do their homework. And then they have to go across town to McDonald's or something. country. So yeah, there are some folks that could have a triple out there, but they're saying, in the survey data, hey, look, it's not enough for my needs, it's not enough for my family, you know, I can't stream or run anything, you know, even for the school stuff, much less for personal for quality of life stuff. So very good question.
My other question was, I really can't see that map that well from here.
Sure.
So I really can't tell which part of the county we're talking about that has most of the bubbles up there.
It would be central and eastern.
This might help.
Because I can see it better.
Sure. This is Tarboro right here. So that's the Fishing Creek Halifax line. So it's up here in the northern half. That's the largest of our coverage.
Is that where my church is? Wi-Fi does not work.
No.
Right over here.
So I'm in the right spot.
Right.
Okay.
Perfect.
Any other questions? We wanted to keep it short and sweet for you guys. You know, are there any key areas we need to know about to be included in this? You know, hey, we'd like to have service to this business park. One of what anyone's talking about, you know, another county's got some shell buildings. They're trying to get service to there, and the current buyers won't go. Because there's no paying customers sitting there, but they need the internet there to be able to sell that property to somebody to come in. And they called us and said, hey, could you get out here? You know, what's the timeline? And we've got our appointment scheduled. Hey, here's what it is. Here's the pricing. We'll be happy to talk further, you know. Let's turn that no, it's not here, no, we can't do it into a, all right, well, what do we need to do to make this happen? And that's kind of the mentality we want to pursue, you know, going forward. How can we help? Any ways that you can help us increase the survey submission? Surveys are going to be all end all for the state. And so we, of course, the applications are due on the 16th, which is two Mondays from now. However, we're going to keep collecting as we go because if we need them for another project going forward or another way with other funding. There's, you know, the RDOF's coming out eventually. You know, is there releasing more information on that through the FTC or the USDA? There are other ways. So, you know, I think we have a very strong shot with the NC Great Grant to win money for you guys to kind of help make this into reality. But we're also going to keep fighting CR in the area to find other ways going forward. So no survey submission is ever wasted. And then lastly, if you would be interested, we do get extra points. The Quake Grant is all scored based on a point system as defined by legislation. We do get a point on that for going in a letter of agreement of support saying, hey, we're willing to get creative. Maybe we have some county water towers or vertical assets we could use, send the survey through the schools. And any little bit can help us to really kind of want to work with you guys to make sure this is the right solution that you guys need, and also we can help us.
How are you getting the surveys to the general public?
We do a lot online, and we do that, which is kind of oxymoron. Understood. But we do that for the purity of the data. That really helps us ensure that the collected questions get answered. And also, we have a speed test option right there on the survey. They can take a speed test and get that information as well. That helps really map that need of, hey, Joe Smith right here has central line service or X service, and is in need better, you know, for their needs. And then also working with local newspapers and community champions any way we can. Some set up the school system, some set up churches to kind of put up the sign-up sheet.
Mr. Edwards, you've been in conversation with
him. Yes, sir.
Where are you on?
So Tabitha and I have had opportunity to meet
you
these gentlemen, Tabitha and I, our CIO. We've had opportunity to meet with them at least twice, I believe, maybe three times. She's met with them a number of other times, and I think they are certainly an incredible firm. They're already doing work in Nash County, Halifax County. Spoke to the county manager in Halifax just a couple of days ago, and he's pleased with your progress so far. I think you're also working in Martin County, I believe, as well, and so just getting started in Martin County. And I think for what they're asking of the county, what they're asking of you tonight is a letter of support. I certainly would recommend that. I do want to note that I had on the agenda, apparently wasn't able to make it, but they referenced earlier Will Berg. He is with Locality Network. They have an office in Pine Tops. They bought what used to be the Crystal Broadband network and equipment and all. And so he has a little over 200 customers. They're doing he's doing is through fiber to the home. It's a much smaller area. It's a much slower build out, but he's covering, I think, providing good service from the folks we've heard from. And so we thought that we would invite them to come together to talk to see how maybe they, the two companies, could work together. And they've had that meeting. I think it went positive. I wasn't able to be there, but I think it was a positive meeting. And they see that where they can you know, work together and share some resources.
Do you have any objections to what? On this request?
Yes, I have some.
Do we need a motion?
Would it be helpful if they took a motion?
Sure.
Yeah.
Questions? All in favor, let me know. Vote sign aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none. Just work with staff and they'll get that plus two. Okay.
Wonderful.
In terms of how we would increase those survey submissions, that is on.
Sure, we can go ahead and we can post that on our website, our Facebook page. We can post notices about around our buildings and get out of it.
Okay, we on board.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Is there a minimum number of towers you have to get through the survey data or before you start construction? Or if we ask you guys to look at one tower at one industrial park, would y'all be willing to do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know if it needed to be a certain volume before you enter the market.
Well, so tying into the network coming out of the neighboring counties, you know, we're able to pretty much extend that out. You know, we can get about 3 to 5 gigs, 20 miles through the point-to-point links. That, you know, it can be done. Basically, yeah, point to where you want it. So yeah, again, in its road. Hey, we'd like to look at what this would look like. Can you pull that up there? That's exactly what we're looking to help with.
All right, thank you.
Thank you so much. Chairman, I'm excited to hear about that. I just came back from D.C. and one of the presenters did just the exact same thing on Paul. I already wrote it back to talk about it.
As y'all will remember, I think about in 2009, we got a grant from Goldie Foundation to do a broadband feasibility study. Our hope was to take that information and maybe apply for funds from the Recovery Act. We weren't successful in that, but at the time, it was a pretty expensive proposition to recover the account. Since then, the technology has changed a great deal in just the last year or so, especially the wireless capabilities that has brought cost down a lot, and so I think it's a good opportunity. It's the right time for the opportunity.
Thank you so much. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, publication, is there anybody here that might speak to the board? If so, please come forward and state your name and address.
Camille Stancy, 127 Midway Lane, Tarver, North Carolina. My mail address is P.O. Box 1391 Pine Top. Now, I can relate to what you guys are talking about. I have SentryLink. Like I said, I live 3 miles out of Pine Top, 7 miles out of Tarver. And I can only basically do one TV. So when you're at home, you want to save internet, so you want to use your phone. But I got a limit on my phone because I pay for all that stuff. But my point is, I can relate. Now, when I go home tonight and try to upload this video, let me go back. With my SentryLink, I can't even run a doorbell, plus my TV. So not even counting me trying to upload my video tonight. What I had to do is go buy a power pack from Verizon that cost me more money just to upload videos. But I only get, 20 gigabytes? So I can use that in 2 days. So I'm out of it. I probably just got it on the 19th, and I'm out of it already. When I go home tonight, it may take me 3 days to upload, or longer, just to upload this hour video. Mm-hmm. So we need it. Because I'm spending all kinds of money. I'd rather spend all my money with them than spend it in all these different places. So you need to come to Pine Top. As I said, 7 miles out of Pine Top, out of Tarver, 3 miles out of Pine Top. And you got all the way to Wilson County, to Pitt County, down in Michaelsfield and Chris, where you're going to need get a whole lot of service. And you know, it's a poor county, so you should get what you need. But I want y'all to hear that before then. And let me give you my card. Because I help you get the word out. I'm spending a whole lot of money for free, because I don't get paid to do what I do.
Is there
Anybody?
No, I ain't finished.
We got 3 minutes.
Okay, all right. Another thing, I went on the website and tried to pull up the minutes from you all meeting. And the last one I could pull up was June. So what's going on with July up until today?
We'll check on that. It sounds like that's the case.
Anybody else call?
Yeah, that's what I've been asking.
Because I want to know what's going on, especially, I had a couple meetings in June, January, going to be fixed in a call meeting. And so I want to pick up on the minute. And I think that's good right now.
That'll be there by the end of the day.
Thank you, sir.
Anybody else?
Okay, thank you.
Moving on to other business. Consideration approval of budget amendments. Is there anything that we want to do with the board?
Yes, sir. I'd kind of like to point out a few. If you look at budget amendment number 3, you'll see the number at the top right corner of the budget amendment. Under purpose, you'll see it says DOT moving of infrastructure in Kingsboro. I just wanted you to know this was the action that you took at our joint meeting with the school board. This is the budget amendment. Budget amendment number 6 says to move funds within line item for Hurricane Florence response. You'll remember, I can't remember exactly when it was, sometime that you did approve to appropriate $25,000 for our cost in responding to Hurricane Florence. What this does, we needed to move those out into those individual line items. So it's not appropriating new money, but just moving that money out into those appropriate line items that you'll see there. Budget amendment 9A, you see there is a 9, and then there is a 9A. You'll see it says to allocate for rollback vehicle. This is a truck equipment, heavy equipment that was approved in the CIP this year for solid waste. There was, if you'll remember, we had corrective measures that were done in the past 3 previous years. We spread it out over 3 years. The last of that contract was done last fiscal year. That got to the end of the fiscal year and the work wasn't quite complete. The invoice wasn't submitted until after the beginning of this fiscal year. So some of the costs for that, unused last year, paid for in this current fiscal year. So this is a truck that we really do need to purchase for solid waste. So my recommendation is to appropriate that $35,000, which is the additional that's needed for the purchase of that piece of equipment. Budget amendment number 21, actually amendments 21, 22, and 23. You'll see there's already a handwritten note at the top of each of those that says to correct budget entry posted incorrectly after the budget was approved. These are budget amendments that you had already approved, but they were keyed incorrectly, and so this is to correct those. So this is not any new money from any sources. It's just for your information to let you know that those postings are being corrected. And finally, you should have at your place, it's actually 2 pages, one budget amendment from the health department. We try to squeeze these in when we can since you only meet once a month primarily. And so this is a fairly routine budget amendment from the health department, and I would ask you to consider to add in that as well. So it would be my recommendation that you approve these budget amendments as presented. Happy to answer questions on any of the others.
Any questions?
Reallocation of budget
for
what phone bill? Main office phone bill?
For the health department?
I'll ask Catherine if she can respond to that.
Yes, sir. The budget amendments are for the internet services with the health department. We were previously told that they had been changed, and health department, the service that they were providing by Cabela's. Cabarrus County had not been cut off, and a new internet service had been started with another company, but CAP was not in use immediately. tell you what that was. But anyway, the line item came up short this year because we have been paying $2.5 million.
What did Cabarrus County have to do with?
That would be an IT, or unless William knows something else about it. But I asked the same question, but I don't know the answer to that.
I'm not sure what Cabarrus, is it Cabarrus County, Karen?
Cabarrus County, back when the county had trouble with our internet service, gosh, 4 or 5 years ago, when a lot of computers came online, we were not able, we didn't have enough
bandwidth
to stay on the county system. So therefore, at the time, the county manager asked us, and this was a grant that had gotten for DPH, Department of Public Health, for counties to be able to access at a really reduced rate. And so it was approved for us to sign on with them, and we did for several years. But now the county evidently has enough bandwidth to bring us back in-house. And so, therefore, that's what that was all about. But as far as cutting it off, you would have to speak to IT.
Any other questions?
For the one that we're just talking about.
Same question, but Ron, who said $1,500?
All right, so those are giveaways for educational purposes in the health department. It could be keychains, whatever it might be. These are typically paid for by different grant programs we get in the health department. They refer to them as incentives to participate in programs.
Another question. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Questions? All in favor, let it be known by vote, aye.
Aye.
All opposed, hearing none. Residents are approved. Go ahead to B.
Item B is regarding a change order for HGP demolition contract. You have there before you an amendment to the contract with Jones Grading and Fencing Incorporated for the demolition of homes acquired under HGP buyout program. The amendment includes the addition of two more structures that were acquired after the original demolition contract was approved. This change will result in an additional $11,150, increasing the total contract to $134,990. And by the way, this is covered under the cost of the HMG program. So I recommend that you approve the change order.
Motion. Questions? All in favor, say aye. All opposed? Hearing none, it is approved.
You have two fees from the health department come before you to increase those fees for both skin tests and pregnancy tests. These were presented to the Human Services Board, and they forwarded those to the
Motion to approve. Second. Questions? All in favor, let it be known by the vote, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none. Motion is approved. Next.
Item D, as you know, in September of last year, a mole was found in the basement of the court. On October 1st, 2019, you approved a contract to remediate the mole. That work involved removing all of the material and cleaning all of the surfaces affected by the mole. Since then, we have bid out the work to replace that material and the related repairs. Of the five bids received, the lowest responsible bidder is H.G. Reynolds. Therefore, I recommend that you authorize me to approve the contract with H.G. Reynolds in the amount of $423,000. Also recommend that you approve the company budget amendment.
Would it be 2 months?
You can do it.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Questions?
Is this covered under our insurance?
Yes, sir. You'll remember before we had you approve the previous contract remediation, we approached the insurance carrier.
If we already paid or approved about $300,000 for just taking out the insulation and things, this is to replace all of that.
That's
a $750,000 process.
Unfortunately, it's bids are higher than what we expected. We did get more bids than we thought. We were hoping to get at least three But, you know, if you were looking at courthouse, it's a lot of tedious work. This is replacing insulation around pipes that's above other pipes of conduit, that kind of thing. So it's very tedious and time consuming.
And we've been able to operate when we took it all out. Is it required that we put it all back?
Well, we explored that. I even explored the possibility of delaying this until next fiscal year. What we're up against is, once it gets warm enough where Lee and his staff have to turn the air conditioning back over that, on in that building, when that system cranks and that cold air starts circulating through those pipes that come down into the basement, all of that condensation will start all over again. We even went back, he and I went back and walked through again this past Friday and said, you know, what do you think? And we just look, I mean, it will be, even if we put the humidifiers in there and all of that stuff, it will be water dripping all over the place. It would be very difficult to prevent.
My question relates to the same subject. Now, have we had the entire courthouse checked to see if there's any more issues with this detail?
Yes, sir. So you, I think I've notified you all that in the mechanical room, which is in the basement, which is where all of our electrical HVAC mechanicals are. A week or so ago, we found that there was what we thought to be mold. We had it tested and found out it is mold. And we had the environmental health specialist to do testing throughout the building. His findings was that is mold in that room. It needs to be sealed off. It needs to be remediated in the rest of the courthouse. There was, they test the air, basically look for mold spores, and they found that the mold in the air was less inside than it is even outside. Because there was concern about some, what was viewed on, I think, the ceiling in one of the courtrooms, we had him to come back, I believe it was Wednesday of last week, to do some additional testing. I've not gotten that written report yet, but from his verbal report to me was that he did not found any additional hazards other than what was already found in that mechanical.
So the hope is that this wraps it up in terms of the courthouse and more.
We hope so, yes, sir. So one of the things moving forward we're going to do, and one of the things he said to us is just, you know, we've had just the right or wrong combination of moisture inside of these rooms coming from these pipes. Obviously the presence of mold spores, which they're everywhere, just needs the right conditions to grow. And then the temperature we've been experiencing, this constant cold, hot, going back and forth. You mentioned they're seeing it, issues of this in lots of other places. So one of the measures, and it's included in this contract, is we're going to install dehumidifiers in the basement. We have some portable ones there now. And we're going to put dehumidifiers in there that will, on an ongoing basis, help keep the moisture level out of the air to keep the humidity down.
So he actually walked in every office, every courtroom?
He went in both the courtrooms. I can't say that he walked in every room, but that's not what they typically do. They don't go in and test every surface in every room. He goes and select rooms and they test the air first, because Wade is explaining it to me and I'm learning more about this than I ever thought. If it's on that ceiling right there, it happens to be mold on that ceiling. If it's not airborne, it's not a hazard. You know, if it's outside, if it's not airborne, it's not a hazard. So they do air testing first, which then prompts them to go and find out where that source is. Now they do look and they walk around. I can't say that they've visited every single room, but based on the testing and the report that he gave, and we have to rely on that. He feels like, except for that that mechanical room, that there are no hazards. Because I specifically asked him, do you feel like that is a hazard to have folks working in this building? He said, other than not to let anybody go inside that mechanical room.
With all
the
stuff that had
a good question. So part of the protocol, and that's why you have to hire somebody that has experience in doing this, they have to put in, the term they use is air scrubbers. So you put in these machines so that they're moving these materials and it's disturbing that mold. It's pulling it out of the air in that particular space to keep it from going anywhere. And plus, they have all areas in now sealed and contained so that it doesn't spread to other areas.
Any other questions? If not, all in favor of the motion, let it be known by voting sign aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Hearing none, it is approved.
Item E, agreement for disaster recovery assistance, 156 Grove Church Road. North Carolina Office of State Budget and Management is seeking to assist Ronzell and Latasha Roberts with mitigation of their flooded property at 156 Grove Church Road. To that end, they wish to enter into an agreement with the county for us to manage the acquisition clearance and related repairs. Like properties in our HMGP acquisition program, once closed, the county will own this property and will have to maintain it as open space. The attached agreement makes available to the county on a reimbursement basis $40,000 for this project. Therefore, I recommend that you approve this agreement as presented in the accompanying budget.
Motion.
So moved.
Second. Just second. Question.
So exactly what are we having this couple do?
They're going to get a buyout from the state. They're getting a buyout from the state.
We are at best.
That's right. Oh. Their flooded home is going to be bought out.
So
like
every buyout?
By the state. By the state.
Could every one of them ask to come through this one?
Well,
just the one time.
Well, this is one that just, the state has come to us and said this is one they've had contact with, they're ready to do. You know, we have others that we've already bought out through HMGP. It works very similar. We get the grant, we handle the buyout, we do, we get reimbursed for that. So this is just a separate program. This is, the state has had contact with this family.
Any other questions? All in favor, let it be known by voting sign aye.
Aye.
All opposed, hearing none, it is approved. Okay.
Item F is the agreement for CDBG buyout program. The North Carolina Office of Recovery and Resiliency through the CDBG Disaster Recovery Program plans to offer flood mitigation through buyouts in areas designated as disaster risk reduction areas or buyout zones. These are areas with repetitive losses due to flooding. One such area is just outside of Pine Tops on Bryan Farm Road, for which the attached agreement pertains. This is a voluntary program. Homes within these areas will be given the opportunity to participate in a buyout program, very similar to the FEMA program we are already administering. The other two buyout zones being considered by their respective municipalities are in Tarboro and Princeville. This program will be administered through NCOR, and our role will be to assist in the closing process and to hold ownership of participating properties as open space. Therefore, I recommend you to approve the cooperative agreement as presented. I'll just add a note, you know, based on the question from the previous one. So right now, there are multiple programs floating around out there, right? And they all work slightly differently. So this is one. This will be one that the state will manage themselves. So there will be no pass-through funds for us. Our only role will be to, you know, help make connection with clients. We will work on facilitating meetings that we had, provide any assistance we can, and once the closing is done, we will be asked, or part of this agreement is the county will take ownership of those cleared properties, and we'll maintain them as open space, just as we do for all of our other buyout programs. So they are approaching this particular program in these buyout zones. So anybody that's in these zones, and there's a map for the one that we're talking about tonight in your package, everyone in that zone will be offered a chance to participate, whether they have applied for the buyout before or not, whether they have put their name on the list for their home to be repaired or not. They'll be offered the opportunity to participate. It's voluntary, it's not mandatory. And so this will be the CDBG buyout program. The other two areas, there's a buyout zone in East Tarboro, there's a buyout zone in Princeville. Those towns, in fact, Tarboro has already done what we're doing tonight. In fact, I think they had a meeting last week, they invited residents in that buyout zone to come and hear more about it. So if you approve this tonight, we'll be working with the state to have a similar meeting for the folks in this area of Pine Tops, or just outside of Pine Tops. schedule a meeting in the next couple of weeks, so by the end of the year.
Another question. Motion to approve.
Second.
Question. All in favor, that being number one, sign aye. All opposed, hearing none, the motion is approved. We have appointments of nursing home adult advisory committee. We have no recommendation to bring from anybody from.
I want to ask one final question, which is our final topic, which is bold predictions.
It's not.
So I'm going to ask each of you to make a bold prediction of something that's going to happen this November. Why don't we start with you?
Well, I'm out of prediction business because I thought Hillary Clinton would be president of the United States. So I agree with that, but I do believe that it has to be going to January.
Is there anything to be brought to our attention?
No, sir. Happy to answer.
Motion to approve? Second. Questions? All in favor, that being number one, sign aye. All opposed, hearing none, approved. Department reports, Ms. Evans, you have an additional information about the board on any one of these?
Yes, sir. I'd like to highlight a few things. Item C, hurricane recovery update. I do want to note in your packet, you'll see a flyer for a legal aid outreach that's going to take place on March 12th, 6 to 8 p.m. This is the second one that's been held, and this is open to the public. They, in particular, will be dealing with ownership issues, in particular for those who've applied for one of the various recovery programs. So just want to make sure the public is aware of that. Also, you'll see Ms. Teresa Lewis, tax administrator, has a memo there that's informing us that we'll be scheduling the convening of the Board of Equalization and Review at your April meeting, and that will start the process of hearing appeals on tax relief. Item E says new law regarding land use. There's a state statute that's been passed, it's referred to as Chapter 160D, and what the state is doing in this is requiring all units of local government to review their ordinances, their unified development ordinances, to make sure that they meet certain standards of consistency, and that we look at those to see if there are any changes that need to be made. So they have put out guidance as to language that should be used in these ordinances. I wanted you to be aware, because our unified development ordinance is a pretty thick document, so it's going to require a professional to go through that document to compare it to what the state recommends, and then to bring recommended ordinance changes to us. So I plan to work with staff. We're going to go out and solicit proposals from professionals to do that. That's what most other counties and towns are doing. And so probably by next month's meeting, we'll have a recommendation for it.
Any questions from the manager on any of these items on the department reports? Hearing none, manager's report, please.
I do want to point out, I know you get this report from the monthly, the workforce development indicators. One of the things that we look at is we look at the what our unemployment rate is and what our rank is. And I don't know, I can't remember exactly how long I've been doing this report for you all. We have at times managed to get out of the top five highest unemployment rates. And I could not wait to come and report publicly. We are number 10.
I saw it was the page
now. We're under 5%,
4.8%. 4.8%. That's promising to us, who knows where to go next month. As you've seen over the months that we've been sharing this report with you, it does kind of go back and forth a little bit. Not only is this the highest rank we found ourselves in, but it is the lowest unemployment rate we've had since we've been doing this report. I think I looked back and saw when I first started doing the report that, it was around 11% at the time. You can see July, I think it might have been higher a couple of times since then, but it's been a tremendous change. Certainly for our, North Carolina economy as a whole, our country as a whole, but we're glad to see some improvement for us there. Item V, Special Olympics update. I'd like to ask you, Mr. Johnson, to come up and give you an update on what he's been working on the Special Olympics.
Good evening, Commissioners. I just wanted to update you guys. Special Olympics of Edgecombe County was awarded $1,500 from the Edgecombe County Recreation Mini Grant Program. We are holding a pancake breakfast fundraiser on March 21st at 7 to 9:30 a.m. here in Harbor Road, Highway 55. The cost is $6 a ticket, and I brought some tickets tonight if anybody wants to purchase some. Anyone can donate to Edgecombe County Special Olympics. You can do that at the E.L. Robertson Center here in Harbor. Please make checks payable to the Special Olympics of North Carolina. Funds will be deposited directly into Edgecombe County's Special Olympic account. We have our own bank account, PNC. Any money that's donated in the name of Edgecombe County to Special Olympics goes directly into Edgecombe County's account. We did set a date recently. May 5th is the date for our spring games. That will be located at Tarboro High School. If you're interested in volunteering, you can either reach out to me or Thomas Perkins, Athletic Supervisor for Tarboro Parks and Recreation, 252-641-4277. I'll be happy to take any questions.
You said the 21st for the fundraiser, right?
Yes, sir, March.
What time do you
think? It is 7 a.m. to 9:30 a.m. at Highway 55 in Harbor. And $6 a plate.
This is Saturday, William.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Next, you'll see item C is regarding an update of Edgecombe County Rescue Squad. And so, we've been meeting with the Rescue Squad leadership for a little over 2 years now. We have been closely monitoring the budget, the need for additional funds from the county. Remember that we additionally have been appropriating every year $1 million a year. The need has increased. Right now, we currently sit at $1.2 million that you approved in the budget for this current year. I submitted a letter to the chief, John Britt, a couple of weeks ago and asked him to respond to some questions. And one, is about are there any cuts that can be made, that the board has some concerns about the makeup of their board. Would they consider changing the bylaws of their board, adding additional appointments from board commissioners? As well as asking what other internal controls that they can put in place to handle on some of these things. And then finally, what they saw that they were going to need for the remainder of this fiscal year to be able to continue to operate. And so he's responded to that, and I will say that the request is for $600,000. So obviously a sizable amount of money. Ask you to consider is to allow me to put this item on the agenda for your retreat at March 16th and give you a little bit more time to ask questions, go into the details of it, and have representatives from the Rescue Squad there to answer questions that you might have, so that as a board you can decide how you might want to proceed.
Any objection?
So
you
need $600,000
this fiscal year?
Yes.
We've already approved 1.2 million.
Yes, sir.
Is it 1.2 or a little more? Have we done some additional approvals?
Yes, sir. We have to help them with cash flow. We typically break that up in four quarterly payments. We have given some of those payments early, but we have not. I don't have the authority to give them money above what you bought.
And I would just say, I've had some discussion with Mr. Edwards and members of the board that represent the county in terms of how we might need to proceed and how we fund the Rescue Squad and what we need to do out there. So it would be, I think, to our best interest to make sure that the chief and try to get the chairman of the board to be at our board meeting, because I think we do have some questions in terms of how we want to proceed. Any other comments from any board members on that?
At the last meeting, I believe it was, we passed information, took action on information. Actually, didn't have to take action, but for Need Incorporated, there was a question about their board makeup. We do have two vacancies on that. One is for a person to represent low-income families in a certain district, and the other is for private organization representatives. So you have that in your packet there. So if you know of someone who will fit either one of those categories, you want to make a recommendation, we'd be certainly happy to put that on the next.
Yeah, I'll probably like that. Ms. Harrison is probably being more familiar with it and how it works and where those numbers need to come from, if you would, look at some proper reference. And if you could have somebody just kind of make for me, because I think we do need representation on that.
Next on the agenda, just a reminder of the retreat I mentioned a moment ago, which will be March 16th at 8:30. We're planning to have that at the Ag Center at Kingsville.
Make sure to get a reminder to you. If there's anything that the board, the individual, think we might need to put on this, and please put it on there. I'm sure you did it with the man. Go ahead, sir.
Yes, sir. And then next is a response to the sheriff's presentation. I know Sheriff Atkinson is here tonight. I appreciate him being here. He and his staff. Staff did a wonderful presentation. I think gave us all opportunity to better appreciate all of the hard work that they do, the number of programs that they oversee, challenges that they face. We certainly want to say thank you to him and all his staff, Sheriff, for what you do. We really appreciate it. The presentation is very well done, by the way. So there were a number of things in the presentation, I think, raised some concern for you as a board. I think that, asked for some response from me. Being a fairly lengthy presentation, I didn't try to, respond to every point that was made in there. I did respond to and talk some about, primarily three main categories, and that being issues he raised about salaries for his staff. Some items he talked about that addresses budget and revenues that come into the sheriff's office, as well as some capital needs that include vehicles, body cameras, and some other things. And so I'm certainly happy to go through this tonight if you'd like. I would like the opportunity for us to talk more at length through these at our retreat, and would encourage to invite the sheriff to come to that so that we can have a little bit more time to really respond to this. My apologies that so much going on, I did not get a chance to finish my review and my response until today, which is why you didn't have a copy of it in your packet when it went out on Friday.
Any objections? Hearing none, we have this as a retreat item. And Sheriff, make sure, Sheriff, you'll please come.
Yes, sir.
Commission report. Anything from the board?
We also talked about public safety. I'm looking to some of those grants that they talked about at the conference for public safety, as well as the broadband. So, I'm going to talk
about that. Any other commission?
Okay. I'm happy to report that I had a little discussion with one of my local built fire people, and they said,
thank you.
I'm not saying monumental amounts, but some of them.
Actually, on the same note, I had some calls from citizens of the county saying that it's exact opposite. And that they're starting to see litter on the side of the road and larger volumes near the dump sites. Mm-hmm. And they're seeing people. And I've asked them to take pictures, send them to staff, put it in writing their complaints. I don't know if you've received any of that.
I have
Well, I will say, you know, even before all of this, we get calls on a fairly regular basis, they do at the landfill as well, about, hey, someone had dumped this and that here or there. And our staff tries to respond to that as quickly and as much as possible. I didn't highlight it, but there is a report in your packet under department reports, I believe, that shows that's one day, I think it was. It was when they go out and do a roadside cleanup, whether it's somebody dumped couches or a bag of trash or whatever, they bring it back in and they weigh it and they keep a track of it. And that report you had is just one day. They went out on one particular day, I think three different sites, and brought back over 300 pounds of trash. So, and this has been ongoing before we implemented the permits. You know, I have heard, had a citizen to tell me they felt like that they seen an increase in it. A lot of the trash is, that they are, our staff picking up is stuff that's thrown or blown, as they say, out, you know, back of the truck. They are seeing some bulk items being dumped. You know, can we say it's because of the permits or not? We'll certainly keep a close eye on that. But they're working hard to try to keep track of that. If I get a call, I pass it on to them. They get a lot of calls directly. We also have some events. There are flyers in there, so we participate with the American Beautiful and Twin Counties. You know, we do some things on our own, try to encourage people to, number one, keep the county clean, but two, to help us clean it up. And so we've got some events that are ongoing that we try to encourage people to help us keep it clean.
Any other questions or comments?
Yeah, on the same note, I gave our county manager, Mr. Evans, a call a couple of weeks ago. One of our areas out in our end of the county is like many of them, but it was horrible. I mean, it was deplorable. And he sent a group out that took care of that, and I'm going to thank you very much. But, you know, in my travels about the county, I don't know if we can promote something on Saturday, April 4th, for Earth Day or what, but we need some help. We need people just to quit littering. I really wonder when the last time anyone has been issued a citation for littering. I just don't know why people can't wait till you get home, take it out of the car, put it in a trash container, take it to the site. It's hard. It is not just myself. You know, it's everywhere. But it is bad as I've ever seen it in trash. I don't know if since I've become a commissioner, make pay more attention to it. I hope I do. But it is terrible in our county on the sides of the road.
Any other comments, sir? Question from the commission.
Mr. Wiggins, I'm sorry. There's one other thing before you go into closed session. I did receive today these packets from Ms. Martha Johnson. Who is asked me to distribute this to you all, and it's regarding, I guess, her appeal about value of her property and some concerns she has about that. Not had time to study it that well today, but I believe she's here today, and just want her to know that you all are receiving the packets that she asked me to distribute. I certainly will follow up with her. I'll make sure that Ms. Lewis gets a copy of this so that she can review it as well. You know, we do have an opportunity to come up soon as we talk about the board organization.
Is this something that would go, have you seen, is this something that would go before the board organization review?
It possibly could. It possibly could. It will start with staff, or staff will need to review it.
Well, just make sure she gets the guidance.
Yes, sir.
That she needs to make sure that she receives the proper appeal on this.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And we'll have this information somewhere in advance.
She doesn't have her appeal.
Attorney's report?
Yes, sir.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we're scheduled to go into closed session discussion, economic development, and a personnel matter. Is there a motion? All in favor, please come by the voting side.